characterize the functions, and then it seems like it just keeps on being like, and then t goes from 0 to 1. I don't really understand why, just like putting it in.
Yeah, the question though, or that I was asking too.
Okay, should we pause and talk about that?
That'd be awesome.
Okay, do you have one in mind?
No.
Oh, I'll make it up. Let me bet. I have one.
It can just be a line.
Okay.
So. Okay, there's a point at 1, 2.
Cool.
I like it. There's a point at 3, 5.
I'm gonna figure backwards. So
okay, that's fine.
1, 0 to 0, 2.
Oh, we had like a team 2, there was one like that, right?
Yeah.
Triangle.
So 1, 0 to
0, 2.
Like this?
Yeah, but it's going back.
Oh,
yeah. Going
okay. Except, hold on, you're not filming this yet, are you?
Oh. Do you know how we do it?
So we got 1, 0 to 0, 2. I was in grad school, like one of the smartest professors I ever had. Couldn't remember which one was X and which one was Y. So
the best of us.
So 1, 0, 0, 2, and you want to go back this way? This is our path C. Okay, and then is we need a field. So any preference on the field that we're working in?
X, I, Y, J.
Okay. Actually, you know, just to make it a little bit, I think this will look a little too, it's going to be an easy mistake to make here, so I'll put it YIXJ.
Okay.
And it'll actually be a little bit harder, but you'll see the distinction. So the first thing we need to do is parameterize this line. And I showed you a trick where just assume the starting point is t equals 0 and the ending point is t equals 1. There's lots of different parameterizations of the line, but this trick always works. So what I need to do is come up with an x and a y, and at time 0, x is 1, y is 0. And then at time 1, x is 0, y is 2. So just concentrate on the x. Actually, I'll do it this way. It's 1 plus something. And to get from here to here, how far do I move in the x direction? So I move back by 1 plus negative 1. And do a quick verification. If t is 0, what's x?
1.
Agreed? And if t is 1, what's x? 0. So that works. Same thing with y. Is what does y start out with?
0.
And? Good. So again, I'm just looking at the y-axis. I start at 0, and I go up to 2. So plus 2t. And a quick sanity check. When t is 0, is y 0? And when t is 1, is y equal to 2? Okay, so now we parameterize this with the i's and the j's. So we just vectorize it. And I just did the algebra simplification, so it looks a little nicer. Remember that this is x, and that's y. And so our integral is an f dotted of dr. And we're going to convert everything to t. So my f function is yi plus xj. And what's y?
2t.
So that's 2ti. And what's x? 1 minus t. And then for the dr, is remember that's a differential. So I do a derivative times dt. So what's the derivative of 1 minus t?
Negative 1.
Negative 1. So this is going to be negative 1 dt. 2t times I plus the derivative of 2t? 2dt. Agree with me so far?
I was leaving off the dt's.
Oh, yeah. But they should be there. Okay. It was dr over dt here, then you wouldn't put it there.
Okay.
It's like we had the dr over dt and then multiply both sides by dt. So this would be negative 2t dt plus 2 minus 2t dt. And with that, so I've got negative 2t plus 2 minus 2t dt, which is 2 minus 4t dt. So that is this integrand. And we made the independent variable t. So it's the variable t that controls this entire path. What t value starts this path? And the t value that ends the path? Is that cool, Travis? Okay.
So it's just kind of like arbitrarily you pick it. It's from 0 to 1.
Right. Is, yeah, it's, there's lots of different ways I could parameterize this line. This is just a trick that always works.
So then if we were doing like a second line, like one of the piecewise ones, mm-hmm. then you know, we just say that it goes from t equals 1 to t equals 2.
No, I'd still go 0 to 1 there. That would just be like resetting the clock.
Okay.
So I'd make it just two completely separate.
And then
clocks.
Sometimes you just add them all up and end, it doesn't matter.
Exactly. Yeah, the value of t doesn't show up.
And then it could even be like, if really it took it like longer to go from the second position to the third position, as compared to the first to the second, it doesn't matter. Okay.
You cool?
Yeah.
So remember, it's, we're very careful, is all of our fields is, the vector only depends on the position, not the time. So if I'm moving slowly, taking me a long time to get to this point, the force is going to be the same as if I got to that point quickly. The field doesn't depend on time, just on position. So it doesn't matter how long I take to get to that position.
Okay.
Yeah.
What was the
Oh, that's what we're calculating. So this says we're doing an integral of f dotted with dr. So that's the calculation from the inside. Yeah. So this is the f. This is the dr. We did the dot product for f dot dr.
I've been imagining that as like how much does the force field like parallel with infinite decimal r's.
Yeah, absolutely right. Okay. So we cool with the parameterization? So the first question on chapter 18, as I'm combining a bunch of different sections together, it's right now you've got three tools for evaluating line integrals. It's the first way is the parameterization that I did here. The second way is the fundamental theorem of line integrals that we talked about last time. And the third way is Green's theorem that I'm going to remind you of here and show you. Parameterization, just did it. Fundamental theorem of line integrals, we did a bunch of examples last time, and now Green's theorem.
So we took the potential function according to the theorem, fundamental theorem of line integrals.
Exactly.
And plugged the limits into that, and get the same answer as this right here.
Yeah, actually, so should we talk about that? Should we talk about fundamental theorem for this one?
Uh-huh.
So exactly the same problem, I want to use the fundamental theorem of line integrals to find it. So we generate this function by taking the gradient of something. We want to find that original function. And remember, sometimes a potential function exists, so sometimes it doesn't. So do you remember the shortcut to see whether it exists or not?
Curl. Second derivative.
Yeah, good. So with a curl, or it's, I'll do it this way, then I'll go to the curl, is I take the y derivative of this, I take the x derivative of that, and see if they're equal. Y derivative of this and the x derivative. So what's the y derivative of the I part?
One.
It's one. And what is the x derivative of the j part?
One.
So there is a potential function. Okay. And then we turn that into the curl, which I'll mention.
Hey, just a quick question. So we take the x derivative because the variable is x, right? If the variable was something else.
It's always the x derivative.
But that's j, right?
We'll talk about that, but yes. It's always the x.
Okay.
So it's always the y derivative of the I part and the x derivative of the j part.
Okay. And that's because the I part was our x derivative.
Exactly. That was an x derivative.
Now makes sense.
And the yx derivative. See the
Yeah, I didn't catch it at the very beginning. Thank you.
Because that means we do have a potential function.
We do.
Is we can generate the yi plus xj vector field by taking the gradient of something.
Like some way.
So that's the x derivative of whatever function is in there, and this is the y derivative. Can you think of something where the x derivative is y and the y derivative is x?
X plus y.
So our potential function is x times y. So to evaluate this integral, all I need to do is f of the endpoint minus f of the starting point. In this example, f of 0, 2 minus f of 1, 0. And this is my f function, x times y. So what's f of 0, 2?
A 0.
And f of 1, 0?
0.
So the value of the integral
zero.
Is 0. But you also would have worked out.
Did you expect that value, actually?
Was it?
Did you expect that value to be 0?
No, it's not clear to me that it would be.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Oh, so what is, remember we're, let's see, so I'm just trying to think of some function. So the x derivative is y, and the y derivative is x. That's the property.
Started with that, and then someone asked
and this is the function.
That's how we look at this.
You see it?
Is he solving a triangle or is it
a triangle? We haven't gotten there yet.
Okay, cool.
So the first question for chapter 18 is going to be: here's three line integrals to figure out. I want you to do one of them by parameterizing the curve, one of them using the fundamental theorem of line integrals, and one of them using Green's theorem. You at least have the first two parts down?
Yeah.
Okay. So then, it's our generic field is some function times I plus another function times j. In our example, the f1 function is y, the f2 function is x. And our check is to see if there's a potential function, is we take the f1 with respect to y and see if it's the same thing as the f2 with respect to x. And then spent a lot of time on this last Wednesday. There's an actual better way to write this. Is we try to see whether f2 with respect to x minus f2 with respect to y minus f1 with respect to y is 0 or not. If it is 0, then this is true, and we have a potential function. If it's not 0, then it's not, this is not true, we don't have a potential. But what we saw was that this is interesting in its own right. We give a name to that, we call that the curve. And where we ended up was Green's theorem. That says, you'd be a little bit careful with orientations. So I'm going to call, I've got a closed curve, and I traverse it counterclockwise. So the inside is going to be called R, and the boundary is going to be called C. Green's theorem says that curl times dA over the entire region R is going to be the same thing. It's the line integral of f just around the boundary. And what's interesting is most of the other versions, the fundamental theorem of calculus and the fundamental theorem of line integrals, is we go in this direction. We go from the derivative, look at the inside as some sort of derivative, go to an antiderivative, and analyze at the boundary. Green's theorem is the typical use case is to go this way. So the idea is an antiderivative makes a function more complicated, and the boundary is simpler than the entire region. So with fundamental theorem of calculus, fundamental theorem of line integrals, the region is a curve, and the boundary is just 2 points. So by going to the antiderivative with a more complicated function, you pay off. But the payoff is you only have to deal with 2 points rather than 8 points. With Green's theorem, usually we go from the line integral on the curve to integrating over the entire two-dimensional region. But we take some sort of derivative, and usually the curl is a much easier function to work with than the original. So the use case is it's usually we're given the line integral, and then we go to the curl and evaluate this one. And a couple things is, do you remember what the circle on the integral symbol means?
Closed
curve. Right, so Green's theorem only works when you have a closed region like this. We've got, I think, 3 examples in the notes. Field is y squared I plus xj. So in our notation, the f1 is y squared, and the f2 is the x. And we want to evaluate this line integral. We've got this vector field around that curve. And Green says we can trade this line integral in for a double integral that we did way back in chapter 15 or 16. So instead of just integrating on the boundary, I want to turn this into a double integral dA over the entire region R. And how do I change the function? Instead of integrating the function f, what do I put here?
Curl of f.
Curl, exactly. So that's what Green's theorem says. Curl is what goes here. So remember, if f is f1i plus f2j, the curl of f is f2 with respect to x minus f1 with respect to y. So for our particular example, what's the derivative of f2 with respect to x?
X1.
One. And the derivative of f1 with respect to y? 2y. I'll turn this into an iterated integral. 1 minus 2y. Okay. And then we can go dx dy or dy dx. It's a rectangle. Any preference?
Dx dy.
Dx dy. What are the range of x values? 0 to 2. And the range of y values? Okay. That's the typical use case for Green's theorem, is we've got a closed curve in some sort of vector field, and we want to compute the line integral over that closed curve. Instead of doing it directly, instead, we compute the curl of the function and then do a double integral over the entire region. So we've got two more examples.
Quite a shortcut.
Agreed.
It's amazing. Yeah. How old is this?
Mid-1800s.
So the curl is not equal to zero, right? So in this case, we know there's no potential function?
Absolutely right.
So is the idea that we can use this in situations where the fundamental theorem wouldn't let us?
Correct. Yeah, so it does have to be a closed curve, but you're right. So if the fundamental theorem applied, then what would you know about it? So if there was a potential function, what would you know about this integral?
Zero.
It would be zero, exactly. So f of the ending point minus f of the starting point. So great. Okay. So if you have, yeah?
Is x and the y range, is always going to be given in the?
Oh, there will always be a picture. So I somehow have to describe the curve C to you. Okay. So in that first question for chapter 18, what types of curves does Green's theorem apply for?
Plus,
exactly. So it's not, if I ask you for one of each and it's not closed, you can eliminate the Green's option for that one. So I've got two more here. Circle, orient counterclockwise. Do that for you. And then I want to compute the line integral around the C. Do you know an easier way to compute line integrals on closed curves rather than parameterizing the unit circle?
Green's theorem.
Green's theorem says that,
what's that word after a circle?
Orient. Instead of integrating here, we just integrate. In front of I is my f1 function, and the coefficient of j is my f2. And how do I compute the curl?
Taking the derivative of the circle.
F2 with respect to
x
minus
f1 with respect to y.
Good, you got it.
4x minus 6y.
Hold on. So f2 with respect to x.
4x.
What?
Oh, you say there was 2.
Oh, good.
2.
Everybody good? F2 with respect to x is just 2? And F1 with respect to y?
3.
So this is just negative 1 times dA integrated over r. And let me make it even more clear. I'll factor the constant out. Okay, so this just says, cut the unit circle up into a bunch of little rectangles, each dx and dy, and then add all the areas of those little rectangles together. What's that going to give you? So I made a bunch of little rectangles. I calculated the area of each of those little rectangles, and then added all those areas together. What would I have?
Yeah,
it'd be the area of the entire circle. So the unit circle, the area of the circle is pi r squared. The unit circle has radius 1. So what's the area of the circle?
Pi.
Pi r squared? R is 1?
Mm-hmm.
Pi?
Pi.
Yeah.
So this is negative 1 times pi. And we get the answer to that integral is negative pi. I know a longer way to do this. So the longer way would be the parameterization of this is x is cosine, y is sine. I plug it into the field, dot it with the dr, and then do a lot of tricky calc 2 integrals and get an answer of negative 5.
If we actually did the double integral, what would our limits be?
What would you do it in, rectangular or polar?
I prefer polar.
Okay, polar. So let's do polar. It's negative 1. Okay, and then what's the dA in polar?
R dr d theta.
What are the ranges of r for this circle?
0 to 1.
And theta?
0 to 2.5.
There you go.
Alright.
If you did rectangular, you'd come up with the equation of the circle, x squared plus y squared equals 1. That's all for us.
You said that was pi squared, and then it turns to pi?
No. Oh, it's, I heard people say pi squared, and I was trying to ask it as a question, and you can't really believe it's pi squared.
So what was the thing, actually?
Oh, so people were thinking pi r squared, and if r is 1, they said the answer was pi squared, which is wrong. The answer is pi times 1 squared, which is pi.
Oh, so that's the r, actually? That's the radius?
Oh, no, this is the unit circle.
Oh, so, yeah, we know the... Okay, gotcha.
Thank you. So, yeah, that pi squared was me questioning, not me affirming. We good with this one?
Yeah.
Okay, one more, and then you'll get the idea. The setup for all of these is we're in some field. Look over your shoulder here. So it's 3xy plus 2x squared. And then I have a fairly complicated region. So I'm in the field 3xyi plus 2x squared j. And then I drew the graph of y equals x and y equals x squared minus 2x. And we do this in another color. As I made a path around this, as I start at the origin, go along the parabola until you get up to here, come back along the line, until you get to the origin again. And I want to know what's the value of this line integral. taught me a shortcut for that. What's that?
What were the points?
0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 3, 3.
Thanks.
And you can work that out. 0, 0 satisfies both. 3, 3 satisfies both.
Wait, 0, 0 for each way?
Oh, so I'm dropping it. That's 0, 0. So Green's theorem says that we can trade our line integral in a double integral over the entire interior. And what do we integrate over that interior?
2x minus 3x.
Let me write code of that. Catch up to you. So Green's theorem says to evaluate a line integral, it's going to be the same thing as a double integral over the region, double integral of the curl. And so partial of f2 is 4x minus f1 with respect to y. Remember, we have a lot of different ways we can cash out dA. In two dimensions, we could go dx dy or dy dx. And if we like polar, r dr d theta or r d theta dr. So are you thinking rectangular or polar here? Rectangular? And then would you go dx dy or dy dx?
Dx dy.
Dy dx.
I'd go dy dx. And the reason why is dy dx is vertical, y first, vertical. And every one of these is going to go from the parabola to the line. If I did dx dy, line to parabola for the top, parabola to parabola for the bottom.
Yes.
You have to split it up into two, right?
Exactly. So it's doable, but it's more work, because as Casey pointed out, you'd have to do two integrals, not just one. Limits of integration for y goes from the parabola to the line. So if I'm on the parabola, what's y?
x squared.
X squared minus 2x. And if I'm on the line, what's y? And then the x values. So for this entire region R, what's the x value that starts this?
0.
And the x value that ends it?
3.
And that's something that we talked about how to do. I can't remember. 16? 15?
That was chapter 15.
Chapter 15.
So for dx dy, it was like a three integral? Like two double integrals, right?
Yes.
Okay, gotcha.
So if you were to do that in polar.
Mm-hmm. It'd be this. So remember, let's see. So if we convert it to polar, y is r sine theta, x is r cosine theta, and then the r's cancel out. So that's the same thing as r sine theta or r cosine theta is 1. Tan theta is
1.
So theta is pi over 4. So you get the polar equation of the line, which isn't bad. And then you'd also have to do the same substitution here. And you'd have something with r's and thetas, and you'd have to pull it out. Mm-hmm. So yeah, you kind of, yeah.
Will you leave our hands open to choose?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so the first, so you're gonna have some chapter 17 stuff on there about vector fields. And then the first chapter 18 question is you've got three strategies for evaluating line integrals. What are those three strategies?
Line integral.
So how do you evaluate the line integral? Three different ways to do it.
Parameterize
I can parameterize the curve and make it a DT integral.
Fundamental theorem.
But in the theorem of line integrals, that's where I find a potential function, just plug in the endpoints and subtract. And the third way of doing it, Green's theorem. So parameterization always works, but it's going to be the hardest. We've got a couple shortcuts. Fundamental theorem of line integrals is we talked about a way to check to see if it's possible to use that shortcut or not. And Green's theorem only applies to what sort of line integrals? When they're closed.
I didn't see you like the R saying. I didn't know.
Don't worry too much. The question was, what if we wanted to do this in polar?
Okay.
Which I wouldn't recommend. For the y equals x, it's the equation would be y is r sine theta, x is r cosine theta. And I could do some algebra to get a nice equation for that. So just to push on this a little bit more, remember that the polar is going to be, you're going to have a dr and a d theta. Is the theta is going to end at this line, the theta is going to end at pi over 4.
That starts from
I carefully avoided that question. So it's doable. That would not be the best coordinate system for this problem. So that's it for chapter 18. The idea of what is a line integral, and then ways to evaluate them.
How many chapters are we?
Chapter 19, chapter 20. Yes. There's not a lot of sections left. There's not a lot of material left. So. I think we're a little bit behind.
Every time I talk to one of Fred's students, I feel like we're like more than one lecture ahead of them. So.
Yeah, my goal is to usually be like two or three lectures ahead of them. If he's running behind in a class, before I've had to cover substitute for him, and I can take him from being behind to being a little bit ahead. I usually talk faster than Fred.
Poor us.
What's it?
Nothing.
Poor you guys.
Yeah.
So ultimately what happens is Fred goes at a slower pace through the course and then just hits the gas for the last couple weeks.
Oh, no.
And I just keep it fast for the whole way. A faster, steadier pace.
I see you really.
I appreciate
that.
So yeah, no, I don't really know which one's better.
Your way is better.
Yeah,
I feel that too. Because then we don't feel them.
Yeah, exactly.
So your second derivative is zero.
Yeah, exactly.
A positive number.
Perfect.
Yeah. Well, that's the same, right?
You got analogies with physics, yes, with math. So yes. So.
19.
That's the way I think about this. My second derivative is zero. Fred's pace increases, adding increases.
Can we go over this, the bonus stuff, or not?
No, in terms of time. So there's some bonus lecture stuff I put together that you can read through. It's kind of a preview for what we're going to be doing.
Are they important for exam?
No, you won't need it for the exam, because we're going to do a 3D version of that, and that is important. Why can't I draw this? Okay, so what I want you to imagine is that you're underwater. So now it's three-dimensional water, and it's flowing this way at 3 feet per second. And you're gonna take a net, so something that's catching the water. It's gonna be 2 foot by 2 foot, and I wanna know the rate that the water is flowing through that net. So let me do this. Quite drawn. This is supposed to be perpendicular for a second
time for the area.
Yeah, perfect. It always starts off so easy, doesn't it? And eventually, this is going to be a crazy curved surface, and we're going to have different velocities at different points, and then we'll just deal with it when we get there. But the simplest possible case.
Why do we have a different velocity at different points?
Oh, eventually.
Because the surface of the water is going faster than down where it has friction on the bottom.
So realistically, because we want a general way, is this will be something that comes up in fluid mechanics, and with E&M, electricity and magnetism.
Physics for me.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, it's a general problem that we can solve with calculus that does come up in real life applications.
Yeah, I know what you're like.
this is how I think about it. And again, for this example, I want to indicate that the water, the flow of the water is completely perpendicular to the net. So I've got a square net, the water is perpendicular to it, and it's flowing at a constant rate. So what I imagine is just watching the water flow through this. So in 1 second, do you see that you get a box of water like this? So in 1 second, you're going to have a box of water like that, 2 foot, 2 foot. And what's the length of this going to be? The water's flowing at a rate of 3 feet per second. We let it go for 1 foot.
3 times 1.
Okay, 3 times 1 or 3 feet. Okay, so in 1 second, we get 12 cubic feet of water. You know what's better about Fred's class? Which he will happily remind you.
Handwriting?
Handwriting, yes.
That's the in it takes, you said minutes.
I did. I noticed that.
Yeah, after I committed myself.
His idea is the same. So a new word is, we call this the flux. So the idea is, we're inside a vector field. In this case, we have the water flowing everywhere. We have a surface, and we want to know the rate that the water is going through that surface, which is going to be in units volume per time, and that's called a flux.
So we were given the rate of the
exactly,
flow
yes.
through the surface?
Yes. So you're given this field is 3 feet per second that way, and this 2x2 surface is perpendicular. And an important way to look, so the way we analyzed this was the 2 foot times 2 foot is the 4 square feet. And then this was the 3 feet. So you can break that calculation down into an area times the velocity. So again, you can anticipate where this is going, is the field is going to be having different velocities at different points. The surface is going to be curved, and the field is not going to hit the surface at a right angle. But we're going to cut everything down into little pieces. And our way to evaluate the flux is to do the area of the little patch times the velocity of the net. Okay, this one's a little bit hard to draw on the board, so I'm going to get to have a 3D mental picture. So I want to be in the same field. So it's 3 feet per second, the water's going that way. But instead of having the surface perpendicular to the flow, is I want to tilt it so there's a 60 degree angle here. So instead of straight up, I'm going to tilt it down by 60 degrees. Is that it? So.
Sounds like the dot product in our future.
Yes, excellent intuition. Which is exactly what's going to happen here. So instead of being scalars, is we're going to be dotting vectors. So
phi is 60 degrees?
Right. Yeah, good. Yeah. Let's use the right letter for that. So I'm going to try to draw this. You've got that same 2 foot by 2 foot net. In this case, correctly pointed out. Remember, phi is the drawbridge, it's how far you lower from here. So we tilted this by 60 degrees. And our field is still all the water, right? This is underwater here. So all the water is going at 3 feet per second. Try to get a mental 3D picture of this before I draw it. So we've got our 2x2 net here, tilted down like this. We're going to watch the water go through it for 1 second. So we have 1 second of water. It's going to be kind of a box like this, but instead of the edges coming straight like this, the edges are going to be tilted at 60 degrees. This would be a side view. And then it would be kind of skewed over like that. So this is 2 foot by 2 foot. This is down by 60 degrees. And there's my 3 foot. Or for me, it was just easier to think of a side view. X-axis. And this is supposed to be the side of that box. If you're looking straight at the side, it's going to collapse down. So this is the area of 4 square feet. And then we let it go for 3 feet. We let it go for 1 second, which gave us 3 feet. And that angle is 60 degrees. Over here, we'll pull out some basic trig facts. I'm just looking at this side view now. What I'm going to do is, so the hypotenuse is 4, and is this height adjacent or opposite?
Adjacent.
So it's cosine. Cosine is 60 degrees.
One.
Yeah, it's either root 3 over 2 or half. It happens to be half.
Yeah.
So that means that this side is?
Half?
No, half of 4.
Oh. 2.
And remember, this is really the area, so that's 4 square feet. That's 2 square feet. And this is 3 feet. So this tilted box, where this side is tilted down 60 degrees with an area of 4 square feet, is the same thing as a rectangular box where this height is 2 feet. In 1 second, we have 2 times 3, 6 cubic feet of water. The flux is 6 cubic feet per second. So let's break this down. Is we had.
Sorry, did you get the 4?
Oh, that, remember that was that 2x2 net that we started with? So we have the 2x2 net that we tilted by 60 degrees.
I thought the length was 2.
It is, but its area is 4 square feet.
Oh, you just took the area.
Right.
Okay.
Are units important?
What's that?
Are units important? For right?
No. Square. 2 square feet? So if we go through the calculation, we have 3 feet per second here, which is the field, it's the velocity. And then what we did is we took the area, this was 4 square feet. And then what did we do to turn the, why did 4 turn into 2? What was the calculation we made?
1 half.
Yeah, 1 half, and why did we do 1 half?
It's a
cosine. Cosine of 60. So area, angle, and velocity. So do you think Travis was right? Do you see a sense of dot product coming along pretty soon?
Mm-hmm. In 1 second, in flex, I would give you this 6 feet per cube.
Okay, yeah, so what I want you to imagine is, first of all, we just let the water go for 1 second, and then we're going to get a tilted box. So in 1 second, we get a tilted box with volume 6 cubic feet. And the flux is the rate, so we're getting that 6 cubic feet for every second, where the rate that the water is going through is 6 cubic feet. Gentle reminder about dot products. So if I want to do the dot product of V and W, we got that this is chapter 13 stuff. And as we know the dot product, we can compute from components, or if we have the magnitudes and the angle, we get this. I'm trying to match this up with the area, the velocity, and the cosine of theta. So when I'm talking about the water flowing 3 feet per second that way, is the way to describe that as a field is that's 3J. And then we want to pull the 3 out of that. So in general, this is going to be our vector that represents velocity. The other two pieces is we somehow want to get a vector for area. So I should start this thing. Flux, as we know, is going to be area times velocity times cosine theta. So this is going to be the dot product of the velocity vector. And another vector here that we're going to invent, which we're going to call the area vector. So what are two things that every vector has?
Magnitude,
magnitude and direction. So let's talk a little bit about this area vector, which is coming from our calculations of the flux. So, given a surface, the area vector, which we're calling A with the line over it. It has a direction and a magnitude. The magnitude is going to be the actual area of the surface. And the direction is going to be perpendicular. Surface. And there's two, well, we'll worry about this in a minute. There's two perpendiculars that we can pick. So for now, let's go with this. So this isn't in the notes. And one thing to keep in mind is a lot of the examples that we were doing, especially Green's theorem was in two dimensions. We're doing flux calculations in three dimensions. So when I write this xy coordinate system here, I want you to remember that we've got that z axis coming out of here. This is the unit circle in the xy plane. I need a vector whose magnitude is the area and whose direction is perpendicular. So what's the area of that circle?
Pi.
It is pi. Not pi squared, it is pi. Very good. And can you give me a vector that's perpendicular to the xy plane?
0, 0, 1.
Good. I'm going to call it k. So if I have the unit circle in the xy plane, an acceptable area vector would be pi times k.
Wait, what was k?
Say it again?
Can you explain again what was k?
Yeah, so remember for the area vector, we need the direction to be perpendicular to the surface. So if the surface lives in the xy plane, then k is a vector.
And the direction will always be exactly perpendicular?
Yes. So to be called an area vector, it's your direction has to be perpendicular.
So k is a unit vector just to specify the direction, and then we multiply it by the actual magnitude.
Yes. Let's do here. Let's imagine this point is 0, 1, 2. This point is 0, 5, 2. This point is 0, 5, 9. 0, 5, 3. And 0, 4. So here's my surface. I'm going to get the area vector. Okay, so first of all, this is a rectangle. What's the base? So we move in the y direction, y goes from 1 to 5. What's the height of this rectangle?
1.
So from 2 to 3?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So what's the area of this rectangle?
4.
And this is in the yz plane. So what's a vector perpendicular to the yz plane?
4i.
So I, and we put it together, that area vector is 4i. And you know, let's keep these. So let's imagine that I'm in the field I plus 2j plus 3k. So what I want you to imagine yourself is you're underwater, and which way is the water flowing? So remember, positive x is toward you. Positive y is over here, positive z is up. So you see that I plus 2j plus 3k is going to be flowing up like this?
Yeah.
So all the water is going to be flowing up like this. Okay. And then what I'm going to do is on the xy plane, I'm going to hold down my net, which has the shape of the unit circle. And I want to know the flux of the water through that net. So what's the easy way to compute a flux? So no hard way to do it. So the easy way is to do a dot product. Dot product of what with what?
Area
area vector with the field. So for this example, the flux. Not under that. So that would be 0i, 0j, yk, area vector. And my field is I plus 2j plus 3k. To get the flux, I dot the area vector with the field vector, and the answer is?
You know, so again, 3 pi.
Okay, so same thing is, I'm going to erase the board over there. It's, we're in this field. This time, this is my net. So it's, I'm giving you the four corners of that net. As the water's whooshing up like this. And I want to know the rate that the water's flowing through this net. Right, so I have to give you the surface. So what's the easy way to calculate flux? You have the dot product of? Of the area vector and the velocity vector. So the area vector, we already worked it out as 4i. Let me just fill in the missing pieces to make it easier to see the calculation. And then my field vector, as I gave it to you already, I plus 2j plus 3j. And the flux is easily calculated by the dot product, which is?
4 plus 0 plus 0.
Good. Which is?
4.
Same thing. The field is given and the surface is given. And then you're just asked to calculate the flux of the field through the surface. What would be good units on this? For what?
For K cubed.
Yeah, good. So it's volume per time for the units for flux. This is the surface I have on. This is the point 0, 0, 1. And I'm going to come out here in the XZ plane and make 1, 0, 1. And then I'm going to come down here like this. So this is going to be the point 0, 1, 1. This is point 1, 1. Okay. So again, we're in the XYZ space. And what I did is I took something in the XZ plane. So basically, my net looks like this. So here's the Z axis, the X axis is out this way, and the Y axis goes that way. So far, so good?
Yep.
Okay. And then I got the water flowing all around. So I'm standing underwater. I'm holding the net that's shaped like this right here. And I want to know the rate that water is going through this. Let's call this as flux. So we know how to do that flux calculation. As we said, it's the area vector dotted with F.
Velocity.
And that's right, so the field gives us the velocity.
So is this. This square is just parallel to the xy plane?
No, it's.
Can you give us the points again?
Yeah, so the points are here.
Okay.
So the way to think about it, remember, when x is toward out toward you and y is this way, is going down like this.
Okay.
So it's hitting the YZ plane, and the X axis is coming out like that.
The coordinates look like
the bottom point, the 1-1-1.
Oh, I'm sorry, that should be 1-1. Oh, yeah. Yeah, my bad.
Okay.
Point taken.
Thanks.
Actually, I did it wrong in my notes as well. So if you're following along with my lecture notes, make sure you correct that. That's a good point.
And what's perpendicular to that?
Say that again?
What's perpendicular to that plane?
Oh, good question.
It's got to be four-dimensional thing?
No. So we want a three-dimensional vector perpendicular to this.
So you find the Planck equation?
So yeah, let's find the equation of the plane. What's the x slope? Actually, you know, that's a harder question. What's the y slope? So you see for y, so if I'm standing here at this point, I move 1 in the y direction, z goes down by 1. What's the x slope?
0.
0. Good. And the z intercept?
1.
So the equation is z is 0x minus y. Or y plus z equals
1. Y and flow in there. X slope, y is 0.
Y is the x slope 0?
Yeah.
So again, imagine the 3D version. Let's see the other piece of paper. So the 3D version is, it's coming down like this. And if I'm here, and move in the x direction only, I keep the same height. You see that?
Yeah.
So if when I move in the x direction, z doesn't change, it means the x slope is 0. And this is going to bring back some chapter, I think this is chapter 13 memories. I can write this as 0x plus 1 times y plus 1 times z. And do you remember how if we have the equation of a plane in standard form, how to read off a perpendicular vector?
Cross coefficients.
Okay. Yeah. 0i, 1j. And you could have gotten that by looking at this. Is you see that it's going to be tilted at a 45-degree angle, and it's the perpendicular vector can't be pointing in either I direction. It's just got to be a j and a k. So does everybody believe that we have a perpendicular vector?
Yes.
Okay. What is the area of this guy?
It's square root of 2.
So square root of 2 on that plane?
No, on the area on
the plane. Oh, is it? Oh, maybe you're right.
I don't know.
I think it's a square root of 2 in here. Let's work on it. Okay, so do you see, so from 0, 1, 0 to 1, 1, 0, what's that distance?
Root 1.
It is 1. Oh, yeah.
I think it's
1,
2.
Good.
Yeah,
right. 3 steps ahead of me. Good job. And then this is a 1 by 1 here. So that's, that length is square root of 2. So do you agree with me and Travis? Travis was there before me, that the area this guy is square root of 2? So let's take this vector is j plus k. What is j plus k? The magnitude of j plus k? Square root of 1 squared plus 1 squared, which is square root of 2. So what's the area of our rectangle here? Square root of 2. What magnitude do we need our area vector to have?
Square root of 2.
Right. So remember that the magnitude of the area vector is the area of this. A vector. Yes. the magnitude of A vector is?
Square two.
So you see we've got it already? So what's the magnitude of this vector?
Square two.
Yep. And what do we want the magnitude to be?
So this is like a special case.
It is.
Okay. Square two.
Good. So everybody agree that this is the area vector? So what two things, what two properties does the area vector have to have?
Perpendicular.
It has to be perpendicular to the surface.
Yeah.
Do you agree that this is perpendicular to the surface?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then what do we know about the magnitude of our area vector? What does it have to be?
Area
of this. What's the area of this?
Root 2.
So we need the magnitude of our vector to be what?
Root 2.
And what is the magnitude of this guy?
Root 2.
So we're good. Great.
And that was a check. Or
yeah, so we threw this out as something perpendicular.
Okay.
And then we needed to see, we wanted to make sure that this length was the area of that.
Oh, so we just checked it, right?
Yeah, for this we got lucky.
Mm-hmm.
Or more importantly, I carefully chose this example so we didn't have to worry about that.
Dang. So
and then
the
next
case.
One, I'll make it a little more complicated.
Okay.
So. The way I calculated flux is it's the area vector dotted with the field. The area vector is 0i, 1j, and 1k. The field is i plus 2j plus 3k. And so to do the flux, it is 0 plus 2 plus 3, which is 5.
If we pick that area vector to be in the opposite direction, it would be negative 5.
Very good. So your insights are great today. So it's, do you see that? Remember, sometimes dot products are positive, sometimes they're negative. So if the net flow is in the same direction as we oriented the surface, that would be a positive flux. There's another vector that's perpendicular to this that goes in the opposite direction, in which case the flow would be opposite and end up with a negative. And just like it's, we can have positive work and negative work, or in calc 1 we had positive area and negative area, so we can have positive flux and negative flux. But yeah, so the sign of the flux is relative to the orientation we chose for the surface. So what do I want to do?
Great.
No, I want to go on to the next example, but what I am going to do is give you guys a break. Take 10 minutes, decamp the technology.
So the one thing I was talking about over the break was which vector you pick for the orientation of the surface. It's for now, we'll pick whichever vector we want. And then depending on the vector we pick, we'll either have a positive or a negative. On the homework, they're going to give you a gentle nudge. They'll give you a clue about which of the two to pick. Like they might say, pick one with the positive k, or pick the one with the negative k. And then, I'll just throw this out here now, I'll remind you later. If the surface is closed, then we're going to pick the perpendicular vector out. So, I've got field. Yeah, what you're picturing is some water is flowing around. In this case, it's positive x, negative y, positive z, so the water's flowing this way. Is I've got a net that's a rectangle with coordinates, with corners of 5, 1, 0 and 3, 3, 0. And for this section, we're finding the flux of the field through the surface. So we know the flux is F dot A.
Yeah.
And the F is easy. I minus J plus K. And the area. So we have to do two things. We figure out the area of this.
This is a rectangle, the base, the 3 to 5 is to, and the length, base to height, I guess they call it, so 1 to 3 is 2. So what's the area of this piece?
4.
And what's a vector that's perpendicular to this?
Z.
Z? I'm going to call that.
Okay.
Yeah. Is that BC? Yeah. No, it is, huh?
I hear it too. Still singing.
Randy Clark.
Hell yeah.
Okay, so I need a vector that's in the direction of K and has a magnitude of 4. What do you think?
4K.
4K, excellent.
4K,
oh. I need a magnitude of 4, because that's the area. Perpendicular to the surface, so K is perpendicular.
Okay.
So what's the flux? It is 4, with the appropriate units, cubic feet per second, cubic meters per hour. We're going to have a couple more of these. If I remember correctly, I went through some homework questions and made sure that we do enough examples in class that we can do these. Okay, so a gentle reminder in your pre-calculus class, Travis. If I have a triangle and I know the two legs and the angle between them.
Sines?
No, actually for the area. The area is 1/2 times A times B times sine theta.
I'm sure, I thought it was more complicated than that.
No, it's not that bad. Mm-hmm. Agree?
Yeah.
And if I have an equilateral triangle?
5 times sine.
So if all three sides are the same? What's the angle?
60
degrees.
Pi over 4.
Plus.
Pi over
2. 3.
Pi over 3.
It's one of those. Pi over some small number. Which one?
Pi over 3.
Pi over 3. Very good. Yes.
I didn't get a Red Bull today, Derek.
So it's according to this formula, it's 1/2 s squared times sine of 60, and sine of 60. Very good. So this is square root of 3/4 times 6. Oh, Terry, do you have a recorder for me? Yes. Oh, you're right. Yeah, for the third one. You are absolutely right. So we got two more examples here. I'm doing this all day. So I have a 2 by 2 by 2 equilateral triangle that's living in the xz plane. And so we've got the field 2i plus 3j plus 4k. And of course, find the flux through that surface. Again, the mental picture is we're underwater, the water's flowing around somehow, we're holding up a net, and we want to know the rate that the water is flowing through. How do you do a flux calculation?
Any time.
Yeah, so F dotted with A. We've got F all right. So F is 2i3j. Okay. Isn't that weird? We were just talking about the area, how to find the area of an equilateral triangle. And then one showed up right here. Very nice example. What is the area of this guy?
One half.
Root three over four.
Yeah. Root 3 over 4.
Times two squared.
Which is 4.
Which is?
Root 3 over 6.
And if I'm in the xz plane, what's a vector that's perpendicular to that?
K.
So my area vector, I'm going with square root of 3 times j. And then when I do my flux, my field dotted with my area vector, I get 3 root 3. Actually carefully erase the board. Next problem is in the same field. So now, it's my surface is going to be the triangle that connects 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1 in the same field, 2i plus 3j plus 4k. So first of all, do you see that's an equilateral triangle? And what's the formula for the area of an equilateral triangle?
Root 3 over 4.
That's 3 or 4 times.
That's square.
Excellent. And what's that distance?
Root 2.
Yeah.
2 squared is 2.
So the area of this guy?
Root 3 over 2.
Root 3 over 4 times square root of 2 squared. Which I'm going to call root 3 over 2. So far, so good?
So now I pick a normal vector.
Exactly.
1, 1, 1.
Good. I'm going to call it I plus J plus K. Yeah, let's call this N for normal.
This has a magnitude of square root 3.
It does. Which is a little bit too long. So we catch everybody up then. So does everybody agree that I plus J plus K is perpendicular to this?
Yeah.
Okay. And then if I, so my normal vector, that's just for they. Reserve that word for something that's slightly different later. So my normal vector has length square root of 3. But what do I want the length to be?
Length.
Nope. I want the magnitude of my area vector to be what?
Root 3 over 2.
Oh. So this is twice as big as it needs to be.
So times 1/2.
So if I did 1/2 times I plus J plus K, which is a half of I, half of J, half of K. What's the magnitude of this guy?
Root 3 over 2.
So essentially got it?
Mr. Smith, on this one, like, I guess
chose this example so you could eyeball it.
Yeah.
But because this is a plane, it is you can get the equation of this plane.
And then you just do a dot product and make something up to make it equal zero?
No, actually, it was like, it depends on how it's given to you.
Okay.
So you, if you had the normal vector, actually, if you're doing dot product equals zero, it means you have to have a normal vector already, which case,
oh, right.
It's like
okay.
A process.
Yeah, that's fun.
But what you could do is if it's given you to the right, if it's given to you the right way, you can find an x slope, a y slope, and a z intercept.
Uh-huh.
And then write it in the ax plus by plus cz equals k form, the normal form, and then extract the coefficients out to get to the normal vector.
Okay.
Is that enough?
That's what you did earlier, I think.
Exactly.
So that's my area of it. A vector?
This is my A vector. So my field is 2i uj 4k. So I first just say the normal vector is I plus j plus k. That has magnitude square root of 3. As for my problem, I need a magnitude of square root of 3 over 2. So I just take half of this guy. Half of this guy is going to have the correct magnitude. Ready for dot products. Let's see, 3 plus 3x is 4.
9 over 2.
9 over 2. So square root of 3 over 2 is just the magnitude of the area vector. There's no vector. This is just how long it needed to be. No, that's not a vector. That's just a number.
We go to vector form.
Right. So we need a vector that's perpendicular to this and has magnitude square root of 3 over 2. So we've got a perpendicular and we shrunk it. This next one is going to appear to be a fundamentally different problem. And I want you to tell me what's different with this compared to all the ones that we've done before. By one square in the xy plane in the first quadrant, and my field is zyi zxj xy. So how is this example different from all the examples we've done before?
It's 2y.
Is we have the variables.
Why do you have 2y?
Oh, that's just a poorly drawn x. So every other example we did was a constant field. This one is a variable field. So what's the velocity?
And you know it's a variable field by the velocity?
Oh, well, I know that the field's variable because they have variables.
On your velocity?
What's it?
Is that the velocity field?
Right, yeah, so think about this. So technically, it's all we're doing is computing a flux.
Yeah.
And then if, you're right, the way I've always done it is think of that as a velocity field. Actually, you're right. Yes, this is a velocity. What you're going to be doing physics 4b is you're going to be computing these fluxes again, but this time with a force field, and that's going to mean something else.
Yeah.
Be right in this class, yeah, absolutely.
Flux field is just
yeah, exactly. So I think it's easier to think about as doing fluxes with velocities, and then we get the intuitions down. You know, I think it's the normal vector for this? But in the xy plane, normal vector is k, every. So if I look at the k component, is, do you see that different points in this square have different velocities?
Uh-huh.
So what's the calculus thing to do? Cut it up into little pieces and integrate. Here is one little patch. What are the dimensions of this patch? So that would be dx here, dy. So my dA, and so I'll use that dA and give me the area vector for the little patch. Is what's the area of this?
Dx dy?
Dx dy,
yeah.
And what's a vector perpendicular to that patch?
Okay.
So my dA vector is going to be dx dy. Great?
Yeah.
Okay, and then my field is, I'm going to ignore this part for now, is it something I plus something j, which isn't going to matter, plus xy. No, that's squiggle j.
Same thing, right?
Exactly. So what I see is, for this patch, only the k component matters. So we'll do some examples later. We can be more careful with that. So what is the flux through this path? The flux through this patch?
X, dy, dy.
Right, so it's going to be the dot product of these two, which is going to be xy is dx dy.
Do we put the antiderivative sign in front of it?
We do.
Okay.
Some people call that the integral.
Okay.
So then,
remove that part from the video,
flux,
please.
Through S. Mm-hmm. Yes, we're going to add all those up. Nicely made this a rectangle. What are the range of the x's? And the y's? Okay, so not too surprisingly, if we have things varying, we cut it up into a bunch of small pieces. And these pieces are so small, you can assume that it's constant on that piece. And then we do the flux calculation, the flux dotted with the area vector. And then, so the calculus move is to add all those up with an integral.
Is there a notation or abbreviation for flux?
No.
I'm very surprised.
I am too.
It seems like the kind of thing that would come up.
They have it in physics.
That's a thing.
What is it in physics?
It's like a
phi.
Capital omega or something. It's like a big I with a circle. And
oh,
then
capital
they usually put a subscript letter.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Depending on what kind of field it is, like B is probably.
Okay.
Yes,
yeah.
That, and then they'll put like a little B for magnetic fields or a little B for electric fields or something, like
okay.
A subscript.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, what we're going to do here is we're going to get what's called the flux density, and then we're going to write the flux in terms of the flux density, and we're going to have a name for the flux density.
Is the density what we get after the integrate?
No.
No.
We will talk about that. It's kind of weird.
That's the total flux.
So we do the flux density times the volume, we're going to get the flux.
Okay.
Start from the day.
Just a quick question. What was the A vector there?
For this one?
Yeah.
There was no A vector. There was a dA vector. And the dA was dx dy k.
Okay. So I just removed it. Does it ask sort of A vector?
Oh, are you talking about the N at the top?
Who? Yeah.
Oh, the N is supposed to be K.
Oh, that's a K?
No, that's an N. So N for normal. That's an N.
It's N?
Yeah, put a K there.
Okay. So what was the N vector then?
K.
Try to follow the notes better on this one.
here. It's in the YZ plane. I've got a square, and the corners are 0, 1, 1, and 0, 3, 3. My field is Z squared pi.
Is that field parallel with the square there?
So the field is, it's all flowing toward you.
Perpendicular
to
I.
In the I direction. Yeah, and then the further up I am, the faster it's flowing. So down here it's flowing slowly, and way up here it's flowing.
So it is going to go through the shape.
Yes.
Just thinking they're trying to trick us.
So, I confusingly wrote this down in the last notes. What's a normal vector to this? If I'm in the YZ plane.
I.
Okay, then. Going to be the calculus move. A bunch of small pieces. So here's one small piece. Is what are the dimensions here?
Z. Oh, that's
dy,
dy,
zz.
Yeah, dy and dz. So my field vector is z squared I. And my dA vector. The area of this piece is dy times dz. We said the vector that's perpendicular is I. So we talked about this for quite a bit of time. To get the flux through a patch, we're going to dot these two. So it's z squared dy dz. This is what integrals were built to do.
1 to 3. Oh.
Yeah, so y is 3 and z is 1.
So we don't solve that
problem? No, I'll leave it like this. So I'll defer that. At one point we solved these. Now I assume you're all experts at it. So we won't
like
waste your
take
time.
With my Calc 3 teacher.
Yeah, exactly. Whoever that is. I think this is just one more for this section. We're going to add some bonus material. We don't have time for it. Why did I call this B? My field is minus yi plus xj.
No potential.
This is true. What are you thinking? So if this was a velocity field, if I was standing here, if I was standing here on the z-axis, feet at the origin, what would I see the water doing? Yeah, the water would be swirling around. Like that.
I know.
Okay, so then.
That's weird. There's no potential for that.
Yeah. Is it, well, is it, if there was a potential.
Right?
No. Yeah, is any integral around the circle would be zero if there was a potential. And if I went around the circle, the field would help me the whole way.
So then they build this towards you? Is that right?
Not this one. So this one, I imagine, right, I think this works. If I have an infinitely long wire along the z-axis, and I run a current through that, am I going the right way?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So then that would be the magnetic field.
So it's kind of like a helix?
No, it's not a helix. There's no K part. So
it just circle around itself?
Yes, exactly. So yeah, every plane is going to be a circle. It's not going to go up or down. And some shape here. This is 1, that's 3. on the x-z axis, I stake out the segment from 1 to 3, and then I go up from a height of 2. And this is in dx.
Are you going to do one more example after this?
No.
I'm wondering what, if we were to tilt the mesh screen.
Oh, yeah, we're going to talk. Okay. So eventually, we're going to have a variable field. And even better than a tilted screen is we're going to have a curved surface. So we're going to have some crazy curved surface like this. So we'll be able to do it for any surface in any field,
okay,
including your tilted one.
Does this field get stronger as you get farther from the z-axis?
Oh, you might be right. Less strong. Yeah, so we probably have to divide by the magnitude cubed.
Okay.
You're right.
So
it's not the real field for it. Okay, what's a normal vector here? I'm in the x, z plane.
J.
And you guys have a drill. Cut it up into a bunch of small pieces. Here's one patch.
Yeah.
What are the dimensions of this patch?
Yeah, it's by DZ.
So the area vector for this patch is what?
DX, DZ, J.
In the field. So the field, I'm going to leave myself a little more room. The field is minus yi plus xj. So the flux through the path is f dotted with dA, which in this case is what?
xdA.
And then the total flux is where I add all these up. X goes from where to where?
1 to 3.
Z?
0 to 3.
Perfect. Okay. And notice I end up with an integral that you've seen before. Skipping a cool application. Good notes for that. Set up for the next part.
Yeah, that's so sharp.
Okay. Notice how I carefully chose flat surfaces for the last examples. So now what I want to do is expand a bit and imagine our surface is given by a function.
It has a root.
Yeah, so let's have a good one. I'll describe it in math. So z equals x squared plus y squared, z equals 1. You have a picture of that surface? What is it?
Circle.
So the cylinder?
Oh, right.
Good, it's a parabola. So that's the bowl. It goes up like the parabola.
Oh, okay.
Z equals x squared plus y squared.
Right.
Yeah. Good. And z equals 1 is the plane that cuts it up. So now our surface looks like that. So we have some field. And now we've shaped the net. So it's kind of a bowl like this.
You don't have that anymore, right?
Oh, that particular example, well, that's way down the road.
So here's the setup. Oh, actually, let's deconstruct this. Big F means I have a function. The arrow on the top tells you what?
Vector.
It's a vector, right? The output of this function is a vector. The fact that I have x, y, and z here tells you where does this live?
Three-dimensional
space. Right? So this is, think about this as a three-dimensional velocity field. So at any given point, I've got the water flowing at a certain direction with a certain magnitude. Okay, then is my surface is going to be given by an equation. So instead of that flat surface before, I'm just going to have some net which is in some shape. So you got the water flowing around, it's going to flow through the net. And I want to know at what rate is it flowing through the net. What would I dot F with?
With the vector, with the area.
Sometimes we call these flux integrals, sometimes we call these surface integrals. So we're going to be integrating over the surface. Okay. So the idea is going to be the same. We're going to take a small patch on the surface, and that's going to be our dA. We've got the F already. And then we're going to do f dot dA. That's going to give us the flux through that little patch. And then the integral adds those up. Okay, here's the idea. Is we know z depends on x and y. So we're going to go down here to the shadow of f. Shadow of s. And then what we're going to get is by cutting the shadow up into a bunch of pieces, we get the patches on the original surface.
Why the shadow turns to rectangle?
It doesn't necessarily.
Okay.
Right, so if it's this shape, what would the shadow turn into?
A circle.
Exactly. So again, we have this, so if the board is the XY plane, we've got this surface out here, and then we look at the shadow, it's going to be some two-dimensional shape that we'll be able to
identify. Wait a second, the shadow for that is not going to be a glass shape thing?
For this one?
Yeah.
That's going to be a circle. Yeah, so imagine, so there's X, there's Y, there's Z, and if just the whole thing got squished down, right, all these parts got squished down, it would be the circle on the top.
Okay, yeah.
See it?
Yeah, sorry.
You might have been squishing the other way. Squishing down.
Yeah, I didn't understand when you say circle means circle. I thought you were talking about sphere.
Okay.
So it is a language problem as well, it's not a description problem.
Which is the best way. So if you got the right picture, it's good. Okay, so again, we have this surface S, and S is controlled by XY points. So if I pick an XY point, I get a point on S. If I take a little patch of the projection, the shadow, I'm going to get a little patch of the original. And then just like when we parameterize curves, is T was the variable that controlled everything, and I could write the integral in dt. Here, it's x and y that are controlling the points on the surface, so we're going to turn this integral into a dx dy. Yeah, so let me show you the details.
Are we going to add anything to those dx dy to bring it up?
Yes.
So that's it. Okay.
Yeah. We will get there. So yeah, basically what we're going to need is we're going to have this little piece in XY.
and then that's going to give us a patch on the surface. And so essentially what we want to do is from this piece get, ultimately we're going to have the dA vector. So for each xy point in the xy plane, we're going to want a dA vector for this patch. Let me throw this out there. So think about, you've got a copy of the xy plane behind the scenes that's controlling the surface. Like for this example, imagine that our function z is x squared plus y squared. So if I pick the point 2, 1 here, that's going to correspond to some point on the surface. What's that point on the surface? I don't care if it's going to be a 3D point, it's going to be 2, 1, 5.
Right.
And if I have the point 1, 3 that's in the xy plane, that's going to correspond to 1, 3, 10. Good. But then we can do more than that. Instead of just picking points on here, is I can pick a patch like that. And I'll actually control this patch is, we'll define it in terms of vectors. So what's that piece?
Dx.
Dx, as a scalar, I agree with you. Dxi.
Oh, I.
So this dxi is going to correspond to a vector on the surface. And what's this guy?
Dyj.
And that's going to correspond to another vector on the surface. And then, so I'm going to show you next lecture how to go from dxi to that vector and dyj to that vector. And then, what are we going to do with these two vectors to give us an area with a vector that's perpendicular to it? Cross product, exactly. The xy plane controls points in the xy plane, give points on the surfaces. Vectors in the xy plane give vectors on the surface. And I'm looking for a dA on the surface, and that's going to come from the cross product of these two. So that is where we're going to start Wednesday's lecture. It's all good, huh? So technology back, Tara.